you on this rainy day, as opposed to when we could have gotten together most any day in the last month and it had been rainy, we are here today. Fortunately, by 10 o'clock tonight, it's supposed to change to snow, so everything will be good. I'm sure I won't have a single phone call all day today about anything associated with that. Turn to the end of Acts chapter 17, and want to look at this morning our reaction to God's message. We have said before we're going to start tonight having revival meetings. Now, whether we have revival or not is our response to what God does. Amen. It's our response to what God says to Shane. In other words, if I'm going to have revival, I have to respond. If you are, you have to, et cetera, et cetera. And I want to start, I think I'm going to expand the reading a little bit. Go to verse 22. It's where we'll begin reading. And this verse, one of these verses, was actually just referenced as an "oh, by the way" last week, and had no idea God would lead us here today. Let's go to verse 22. Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, "You men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed, and the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they might feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of our own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is likened to gold or silver or stone, graven by art and man's device. And the times of this ignorance God winked at. But now God commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom you hath ordained, whereof he saith, giving assurance unto all men, in that he hath raised him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others, we will hear thee again of this matter. So Paul departed from among them. Howbeit certain men claimed unto him and believed, among which was Dionysus of Areopagite, the woman named Demarius, and others with them." That's the reading of God's word, and everyone said,
amen.
God, melt our hearts right now, and you preach today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated. We are going to have some meetings. We'll see what goes on in those. You have an opportunity between now and tonight, or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Again, remind you, Tuesday night, as Brother Chip will be here, a special message for all those that enjoy racing. If you have family, friends that may be out of church and want to make sure they get plugged into that, he has a message that he uses all the different flags that are associated with a race. And he is a track chaplain of the Southeast Truck Series over at a racetrack in South Carolina, and he's done that over the years off and on. So I want us to look today at our reaction to God's message. So let me give you the backstory here. Paul has stood up. This is the message at Mars Hill. And as Paul stands up to preach this message, what has just happened, we need to go back and look at some key things. Look in verse number 5, all the way back in verse number 5 of Acts chapter 17. Because I want to point this out to you, but the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took certain of them, certain lewd fellows of the Baker's work, and gathered a company and set all the city in an uproar. See, we see there's a time of persecution. May I say that America spiritually, at least in the Christian faith, has never seen a time of persecution greater than the American church that we're seeing today. Now, some of that we brought on ourselves because we have different individuals and folks and all sorts of stuff that have invited some of that in because of compromise, but we've never seen persecution just to stand and say, I'm a Christian, greater than it is right now. And by the way, as was given in testimony, it's still better than a lot of places on earth. Amen. Verse number 5, though, there's a great persecution. Look at verse 11 and 12. The Jews at Thessalonica caused a great uproar, and in verse 11 and 12, there's a time of belief. The Bible says, There were more noble than those in Thessalonica, and that they received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women, which were Greeks, and of men, not a few. We see in any great time in church history, when there's a period of persecution, there'll be a period where folks come to faith and come to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. We see in this right here at Thessalonica, there was a period of persecution. The period of persecution led them to be pushed out. They go to Berea, and guess what? Some believed in Berea, and we should be grateful that when others believed. Look in verse 13, though. We see the viciousness of some people. The Bible says, but when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached to Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. Guess what? There's some folks that are vicious. They're not just happy to get some off course. They want everybody to be off course. They want everybody to be miserable. They want everybody to remain lost. They want people to be aside from the things of God. The backstory here that leads up to this message of the sermon at Mars Hill that Paul preaches is simply the result of his persecution, some believing, and further persecution. And in verse 16, though, we see the Holy Spirit goes to work. Now, while Paul waited for them in Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Now listen, church, you might think that we don't have any graven images or certain things that are traditionally called idols, but I suspect that if we were honest with ourselves, we have more idols in our world today than Paul did in his day. We're chasing dollars, we're chasing all sorts of other ambition, fame, and glory. Where I come from, I'm used to telling, if you want your name in lights, just stay there long enough, all three funeral homes are lit up. Eventually, you'll have your name in lights. Amen? Well, that's something to look forward to, ain't it? We got to be careful. We have to be careful at this. Now, when in verse 16 it says, notice the Holy Spirit goes to work, his heart is stirred because as he goes into Athens, he notices all of these things, and the city is wholly given to idolatry. I've not told Brother Chip anything other than giving him the address. I've not said, preach on this, do that, do this, those kind of things. All I know for sure is I can trust that he's going to pray and seek God's face and give us God's word, and that's what we long for, and everybody say it. I wonder what the Holy Spirit's told Chip Bethel's wholly given to. Paul's heart was stirred that city was totally given to idolatry. And when Chip comes here, by the way, we're not here to worship Chip tonight.
Amen.
What can do it? But we are here to worship Jesus.
Amen.
And in verse 20, we see that God's man begins to challenge a group. In verse 20, the Bible says this, for thou bringest certain strange things to our ears, and we would know therefore what these things mean. Now the man of God who's been burdened about what he's seen now has basically been asked, what do these things mean and what are you trying to tell us? He has an opportunity to explain. Now we're at the reading that we had. What happens next is Paul begins to share with them. He delivers a message at Mars Hill. First of all, verse 23, look at this. He reveals that they don't really know God. Now, I suspect in any church, like Bethel Baptist Church, whatever church you want to, there's folks that regularly gather that they are worshiping, much like in verse 23 here. They don't really know God as much as they know about God. I know about some of our nationally figures that we shall use, about our elected officials, but I do not know them. I know about some of you, to be honest with you, but I don't really know you. And nor do you really down deep know me. See, Paul in verse 23 says, for as I passed by and beheld your devotions, in other words, your attendance or how you're checking the boxes, and I see that you've got a lot of religious activity going on, may I say that there's some churches that have a great deal of religious activity that Jesus don't attend. And it's more important that Jesus be in the house than it is that we're busy saying things about him. And in verse 23, he says, I found an altar with this to the unknown God. Now go back up to verse 16 where they're wholly given to idolatry. This is a group that is superstitious. They're given to idols. They have even a God, if you will, or an altar made that says to the unknown God. They're just trying to wrap it all up and say, let's put it all together. And just in case we missed one, let's have an altar to the unknown God. That's called pluralism. And our that today. Oh, all the different religious tenets preach basically the same thing, love and peace and this stuff, and it's really just a matter of heart. Listen, sincerity can get you in trouble. Because I can sincerely believe the wrong thing. And there are people that can sincerely believe when they draw their last breath, whatever they place their trust in, well, they'll be okay. And folks, they will be sincerely wrong. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come to the Father but by me. Look at verse 28. He reveals that they know not God. He also, in verse 28, reveals what the measuring stick's going to be. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own voice have said, for we are also his offspring. Listen, don't be kind of silly sometimes. We say things we're going to look at in just a moment that aren't always true in church. Now, hopefully not from up here, but we don't mean to, but we say that. Let me tell you one that the world says sometimes. Well, we're all God's children. No, sirree. Only those that are saved are God's children. We're all God's creation, but we're not all God's children. I had to come and become a child of God when I was born again into the family of God through the blood of Jesus Christ. And see how those little things can creep in? We'll be there in just a moment. It reveals Christ to be the measure. It says, look in verse 31. Because now here it comes. Because there'll be a day when judgment comes, and the judgment is going to be judged by Jesus Christ. Now, when we think about that, church, that sounds really good in church, but there's a world that doesn't understand that. We need to understand that that judgment one day, the world will be judged, and it'll be judged by Jesus Christ. Now, with that, I know I say this some weeks off, but that's the backstory. I want to give you three things today, just as quickly as I possibly can. There are three reactions in the balance of that chapter that I want us to look at, and I believe it's a reaction I'll have. I believe one of these will be a reaction you have, and everybody that comes this week or chooses not to come will have this week when God shows up to speak to us in revival messages. Look in verse number 32. Now, you still with me? Say amen.
Amen.
Here's what the Bible says, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead. That's what he's preaching. By the way, because if it all ends in a grave, there's no need to worry about being right with God when you die. He's sharing them the resurrection, and the world is going to be judged, and if Christ so arose, then we can rise as well, and all these things. And guess what? In verse 32, he says, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, here it is, reaction number one, some mocked. Do we ever mock God? I suspect we do. Let me give you a definition from one theologian. Mocking God is to disrespect, dishonor, or ignore him. You ever been convicted of something and wanted to get to the car instead of the altar so that you felt like that conviction could get away? You were trying your best to ignore God. Have we ever dishonored him? Absolutely. Anytime we act fleshly, we dishonor the Lord, and we've all done that. Anytime that we disrespect God by lowering down God's holiness and uplifting mankind. Listen, see, the world wants to uplift man and bring God down. The child of God should want to exalt God and bring him down. Because he's the one that's worthy. When we think in the church, look, some mocked. I think sometimes we think mocking's only if you throw rotten tomatoes at somebody. Or you yell profanities at them. Hey, we will mock God this week if we disrespect, dishonor, or ignore him. Preacher ever said anything and you said that preacher? Listening to him. Hey, I don't want you to listen to me, but you better listen to God when God speaks. You ever try to get out of church or get away from it and say, well, I tell you what, I need my good message. I'm going to find me another church. Well, find you one where this is still preached, and what's wrong in one ought to be wrong in the other. Amen? When we look at God's Word, it says, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked. Mockers are usually proof of a lack of obedience. A lack of, if you will, being teachable. I can help kids get better when I was coaching. I can help kids get better at ball as long as they were coachable. But they got to be coachable. How many of us come to church's bases and then tell the potter, here we are, change us if you can. We're supposed to come in as what? Clay. And say, Lord, you're the potter, I'm the clay. Keep molding me and making me and shaping me. And if we ignore God because God thinks he has the authority to get in our grill about something that you think sacred, then we are mockers as well. When we look in God's Word, it says some mock. Charles Finney, back in the 1800s, when Billy Ray first went to elementary school, said this. To mock God is to pretend to love and serve Him when we truly do not. It's a mockery. It's a mockery when He has our actions during a church service, but not our heart on Monday. Now, everybody understand, there ain't no such thing as a perfect Christian. Which works out great, because there ain't no such thing as a perfect lost person either. We're not talking about being perfect. We're talking about being on a true walk in a right relationship with the Lord. What about the language we use in our society? Hey, listen, church. We need to clean our language up. I've battled that over the years, especially high school and right there, you know, in college. You probably didn't want to play Scrabble with me. I didn't use big words, but I knew how to use bad ones. Some of you battle language to this day. Some of the words that used to be get your mouth washed out with soap. By the way, anybody ever had that pleasure? Raise your hand. Got your mouth washed out. My grandmother had Dove soap. I don't even know if they make that anymore. But as a little boy growing up in the country, I promise you I had more of that Dove soap in my mouth than I ever did on my hands, because I didn't wash my hands in a lot. What about our language? Words that used to be considered slang and inappropriate are now commonplace, even among God's people. See, we've let the devil bring them. What about symbols? We need to be careful. Teenagers, adults, does your clothing adorn such symbols that maybe you're not aware of the history and need to be? Such as some of the peace symbols and that stuff, which is Nero's cross turned upside down, where he would take Christians and crucify them and kill them in various forms and fashions. Sometimes it may even be pictures that we have like this in our church, not to rattle your cage today, but we need to be careful. Jesus might not be as white as you think He is. He might not have looked just like you thought He looked. We need to make sure we don't turn some of the pictures that we have and we put up in reverence to be honored. What about stories that people tell? Best I can tell in reading the Bible, everybody that saw Jesus is recorded here, physically. We need to be careful we don't buy into fables and then try to pass them off as true doctrine. See, I'm getting you grilled today because I want to challenge you. What about false teachings? Well, it's just a little false, preacher. That's okay this time. Oh, that's okay, preacher. Hey, listen, I'm never going to put somebody at this pulpit that I don't have total confidence they pray. And even this week, if he gets up here and he says something out of the scripture, he and I are going to talk. Because I got to worry about you and defend you so you don't go out here with the wrong idea. That's why I don't just yell at the pulpit to anybody. I'm good, but I've got him because I know him to be faithful steward of the Word of God. What about the world? Has the world crept into the way we think about church? Preacher, we can't do that over there. What do you mean we can't do that? Well, I know they're not in God's Word and God's will, and they're not really doing anything. Matter of fact, they're not even really a good church member, but they tithe a lot. So, by the way, we all should tithe the same. A tenth's a tenth. Now, you might give an offering above that, but a tenth is a tenth. And that's what God said He did. That's what He says He expects. Don't mock God. Don't be a group that mocks God. We need to make sure we honor God. And instead of disrespecting, we show respect. Instead of acting disorderly, we act orderly. And instead of ignoring Him, we ought to be attentive. And if He tools your heart this way, He tugs at your heart, you ought to run to the altar or bow on your knees where you are and cry out to Him. Not for a show. It ain't about having 200 here this week. It's about being closer to God and saying, God, here I am. Send me. Not mock God. Number two, look in verse 32. Aren't you glad there's just three? Some mocked. And others said, we will hear thee again on this matter. Some waited. Let that sink in. I'm going to wait. Some waited. Oh, we'll hear you again on that. You know the number one lie I've been told as a preacher? It's when I go to somebody in the church and say, man, we need help in this area right here. Will you help us? And what they really want to say is, no way, and I hate to tell you that, so here's what they'll say. Let me pray about it. Can I get back to you? And they're thinking, man, he's got a week to forget he asked me that. Some said, let's wait. Wonder how many people are in hell today that heard a message at a church service and didn't get back to church or didn't give their heart to Christ and died still in their sins because they said no, maybe later. I'm not old enough. Parents, I've got a teenager. I've got another one on the way, unfortunately. Not to this earth, to teenage years. Got another one on the way. Woo! I want you to know the devil understands something that maybe we don't get sometimes as parents. If you wait to think that they're only facing adult stuff when they're adults, you're foolish. They're facing it when they sit down with you in the living room, in their crib, and already seeing things on the television and stuff. And they're hearing things on the school bus, and in the classroom, and on the playground, and on their ball teams, that you and I might not have dreamt of before we were well into our adult years, but they're hearing it in elementary school now. Wonder how many times we keep waiting on them. Well, they just so-and-so. We make excuses for them. By the way, some of you, we made excuses for them when you were teenagers, and now you're 40 and still in a spiritual mess. And you keep waiting. When I get a little older, I went, look what it says in verse 32. Others said, oh, yeah, that's good. We'll hear you on this matter. Can you come again next week? Here's the reality. The preacher may not be able to come next weekend. You may not either. So if you show up Monday night and God speaks to you, you better do whatever God says on Monday night because he ain't made it Tuesday yet. Matter of fact, he may not let us get back tonight. We need to understand that we're not guaranteed getting the opportunity to hear it again. These people took for granted they'd have another week. We need to understand something. We need to be willing to make a decision immediately. Look in verse 33. Some mocked, some waited. In verse 33 it says, so Paul departed from among them. You know what's going to happen Thursday morning? If the Lord tarries, Chip's going to check out a hotel. He's going to leave. And you're still going to be left to deal with the truth that's been preached and taught. How long are you going to do that on Sunday morning? And Wednesday night? And Sunday morning? As long as I'm a pastor, I hope to give you truth every day. Look at verse 34. I got good news. Some mocked, some waited. And in verse 34, howbeit served me and clave unto him and believed. Aren't you glad some believe? Say amen.
Amen.
I want you to know the last week already been in the other category. But I also want you to look at this here because not just mental intellect. You know there's lots of people that believe in their mind that God has never had a heart conversion with them to where they're truly born again. Now listen, we went through this in the 90s when people started saying, oh, those preachers, y'all want to calm down a little bit. We don't want people to doubt their salvation. Hey, if you're sure, you don't have to doubt. Make your election sure. The Word teaches us clearly. Be sure. Let's serve the Lord. Some mocked, some waited, but some believed. You know what I think is going to happen this week? I believe there may be some names in those baskets, and I'm going to ask you in a moment to come and pray for them, just like we do normally in the midpoint and that kind of stuff. Maybe you want to pray in just a minute. I don't want to be a mocker. In other words, I don't want to disrespect him. I don't want to dishonor him, and I certainly don't want to ignore him. There's a picture that's out, and I'd be lying if I told you the artist or anything else some years ago, but it was a picture of Revelation 3:20 where Jesus stood at the door and knocked. And somebody pointed out, do you know that the artist left off a door, latch, knob, handle, whatever, on this side of the door? And when they asked the artist about it, he finally said, no, I left that off on purpose. Because Jesus stands at the door and knocks. But he ain't going to invite himself in. Amen. You've got to open it from the inside and say, come in.
Amen.
Oh, that needs to be our prayer. Lord, don't let me disrespect, dishonor, ignore him this week. I don't want to be a mocker. Lord, don't let me wait. When I hear God, I want to respond. In verse 34, it's not just mental intellect, but it is making a true commitment. When it says right there that they believe, it's not talking about they just believe and got saved. It's talking about they not only believe, they made a commitment to stick to the true doctrine and stick to what Paul had been teaching. Because guess what? While they believe in the resurrection, there's lots of other people around them that still don't. You know, while you believe that Jesus is the way, there's still lots of people around you that believe he is not. There's others that believe he is a way, not the way. We need to understand in our world today. Look at the end of verse 34 real quick. It says, among the which were Dionysius, the Areopagite, senator, probably the judge. Remember now, he's basically on trial here. He's been brought before a religious group. He is having to explain this in the form of a sermon. And let me tell you this. When the fire turned up a little bit on him, the heat got up. I think he remembered a story, perhaps, of three Hebrew boys, and when the fire got turned up, they looked around. One of my favorite texts in the Bible is in Daniel chapter 3. Over in Daniel chapter 3, I remind you that there were three little boys that wouldn't bow down, and the leader threw them in the fire first. Now, you still with me? Say amen. Now, listen, I'm going to show you this. When God's people will glorify him, even the lost people can see Jesus. Here's how I know that. Those three boys were in the fire, and the high, it was so hot that when they threw them in, it killed the people that threw them in. Y'all still with me? That's in your Bible too, ain't it? And in Daniel chapter 3 and verse 25, it says, Nebuchadnezzar looked around and said, how many did we put in there? And they said, we put three, O king. He said, well, I see four, and one looks like the Son of God. How do you know what the Son of God looks like? Because those people can see Jesus when saved people see Jesus. Now look, Paul gave just a short, brief message. I know y'all are thinking, boy, we wish you could preach a whole message in 8 verses. I do too. Just think, if I talk slow, y'all wouldn't get out at 2 o'clock on Sundays. This guy that was the convert started out as the judge. Many theologians believe he was the judge. And when Paul got through preaching, he was one of the ones that believed. Your biggest critic, your biggest enemy in the faith, your biggest obstacle in the faith may be just the one that gets saved if we'll keep telling them about Jesus. Somebody said, well, who's this other person? A lot of theologians believe that was his wife. Guess what? When a husband and wife both get saved, it makes a happy home. Mm-hmm. And when the husband and wife get saved, it may make a difference in the lives of their children and every generation after them. This week, I'm going to challenge you in just a moment. Maybe we need to come pray. Oh, God, don't let me be a mocker. Oh, God, don't let me be a waiter. Oh, God, whatever you say, let me be a waiter. Simply, in standing feet and bowing down. In just a moment, he's going to come sing and play. Many people there didn't believe, but some did. It gave us two. And we are. Maybe there's still a desire here. God's been doing something for weeks. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Nobody's looking around. First of all, you're here today and don't know Christ as Savior. I want to show you God's Word. It's not my opinion. It's not anything that I came up with. I can show you in God's Word where it says, if you'll confess with your mouth and believe in thine heart the Lord Jesus Christ, that you can be saved. So maybe that's you today, and you need to be saved. If that's you this very hour, then as he begins to play in just a moment, you don't have to wait on anybody or about you. Come and just tug me on the arm. Grab somebody you know that's beside you that's saved and said, will you go with me? And I'll show you God's Word. Maybe there's others here today that just have been sensing God's presence. And you know, now as these meetings are here, we don't want to be a mocker. We don't want to be a waiter. We want to be a believer and a responder to whatever God says to us. Maybe there's others here today that just want to come and Get one of these names out of the basket, because you've invited them to these revival meetings. And you want to pray that they'll show up. And when they show up, we pray that they'll answer God's sweet calls. It's your time. But let's pray for these lost people. Let's pray that we won't be mockers. We won't be waiters, but we'll be believers. God, your will be done. In Jesus' name. Amen. You be obedient to the voice of God as he says.